Thank you. morning. Oh, so one announcement is you'll see some beautiful flowers that are here at the front at the altar. And these were flowers from Marge Saunders' memorial service. So just look at them and enjoy them, obviously. Does anyone else have any announcements to make? John? No password, right? No secret handshake? All right, we're good? All right, that's it. You can't remember it? Yeah. So if you go into your bulletin, in the very front of your bulletin, we'll be reading the call to worship in unison. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's sing together. He is Lord, He is Lord, He is risen from the dead. Every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Let's stand together as we sing.
Save her.
You may be seated.
And some requests, concerns. When Kathy is here and well from her surgery, please see her.
Good.
We keep Mike and Kara in our prayers. And Mike is home. And Dottie and Tim Lieberman. She's having a hard time getting up and down the steps since of her knee in her back. And to go visit Tom in rehab. And prayers for me. My home scan showed I have a couple nodules on my right eyelid. And then I'm going to have an angiogram on Friday. So, anybody else got any prayer concerns?
Continue to remember those that have been affected by the storms and the floods. We have been so blessed not to have anything catastrophic come our way. Just over the bridge, you saw what happened. Those major thoroughfares in Philadelphia and what have you. And then, of course, back down in Louisiana and other places. We received word also that some of our churches in the northern part of the state had damage due to the tornado. And so calling out that we as a denomination remember some of our churches, they suffered damage. Roofs were blown off, electrical work, etc. So let's remember some of our congregations. Take your request to God and let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We have so much to be grateful for. We gather together in your presence to give you thanks. You're a good God. And you watch over us. You take care of us. Grateful today for answered prayer. Grateful that we as a church congregation have not been affected by the storm. Even as Lynn shared, how her son John able to weather the storm and be protected as he was journeying home. Father, we pray for our church family. Thank you that Kathy's with us. Continue to lay your hand upon her. We continue to pray for the Liebermans, pray for Mike. Father, we pray for Trudy as she continues with her tests. Remember young Justin today. You'll be with him. We thank you for safe return, Kyle and Madeline. And we pray also for Robbie as he goes back to school. Father, we pray for the condition of our world. We look out Things look so ominous. We are just so concerned. We ask that you look down in your kindness and you have the answers. We don't. Washington, D.C. does not. But you're bigger and greater than any power on earth. Amen. So we trust you for our future as people. Teach us to pray as you taught your disciples, singing together. Our Father,
thank you.
if you can stand. That's in hymn 219, verse 27, verse, Jesus paid it all.
A very famous British Prime Minister once said these words. We make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give. We come to the time of the offering this morning, and it's an opportunity for us to return to God a portion of the blessings that He has bestowed upon us. And so may God bless us as we think in terms of the life that we make through our giving. May others be blessed as we give. Father for being so involved in our lives. Thank you for giving us this opportunity during our time of worship to say thank you to you. And so we say thank you, and we are deeply grateful for all that you are and all that you are doing in our lives. Bless the gift this morning. Bless the giver. That the name of Jesus might be proclaimed throughout the land. In his name we offer this prayer this morning. Amen and amen.
Be seated. Joyce comes with this scripture.
Good morning. I'm going to be reading Leviticus 17, verse 11. For the life of the creature is in your blood, and I have given it to you to make an atonement for yourselves on the Lord. It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life. Leviticus 23, verse 27. The 10th day of this 7th month is the Day of Atonement. Hold a sacred assembly and deny yourselves and present a free offering to the Lord.
There is, however, one thing in common that our Jewish friends have with each of us as Gentiles.
Rather than the murders, my name.
They will,
meditations,
seek a better life
of our hearts.
Resolutions will be made
acceptable.
In a work, sight,
thy word
committed
is quick and powerful and sharper and rusty.
Not in schools, at least in Pennsylvania, I think here in New Jersey, have holiday. Much of the day spent in synagogue. The rabbi will blow the shofar. There will be prayers, endless prayers, from a special prayer book. One of the very, very significant parts of Rosh Hashanah is the eating of apples dipped in honey. What does that signify? It's a wish for a sweet New Year. That's the beginning of these most sacred events in the life of our Jewish friends. 10 days after Rosh Hashanah, there will be another significant event known as Yom Kippur. Yom Kippur is found in Scripture, the book of Leviticus. You heard it. It will be observed. Why is Yom Kippur different? Given to Moses by God on the 10th day of the 7th month, there will be a day of atonement, a holy convocation. You shall gather together. God gave not only to Israel, but it has never been abrogated. It is celebrated still today. Let me ask you a question. What do you understand about the term atonement? You obviously are aware that through all of the messages that I share with you, I take the opportunity for it to be also a time of teaching. What do you understand by the word atonement? Atonement means days of forgiveness and a time of confession
intercession both as a nation and as individuals. Now I want to take you, if you've not been there, as to what exactly happens on that day. Not now, because again, our Jewish friends, unfortunately, are waiting for a deliverer. Our deliverer has come. Can you say amen?
Amen.
The most important person on that day, Yom Kippur, the central figure, was the high priest. He alone was the only individual that could enter the Holy of Holies. He had to make atonement for himself. How was that done? He was set aside for 7 days, separated from the people. He washed his body 5 times and his hands 10 times, his hands and his feet. He was assisted with 500 other priests. The sacrifices on Yom Kippur were 2 goats. The scripture clearly even names them. One of those was the scapegoat, given the name of Azazel. And what would the high priest do? He would lay his hands on the scapegoat and make intercession and pray, intercede, and he confessed the sins of all of the people, the nation of Israel, that had gathered, see, for forgiveness. And then after he did that, he would set the scapegoat free, and the scapegoat would run to the hills, to the mountains, as a type of Christ who was led forth, as the scripture says, without the city walls, bearing the sins of the people. What happened to the second goat? The second goat was killed by the high priest. And the blood was gathered to make atonement for all of the uncleanness and the transgressions of the children of Israel. Also, individual families brought bullocks, pigeons, lambs, whatever they could afford. And the climax, hear me, of the Day of Atonement was when the high priest, and he only could, no one else, when the high priest would enter the most holy place, the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was placed, and the mercy seat, and the Shekinah glory, which was the visible presence of God. And after killing the second goat, he would take the blood and sprinkle the blood, and sprinkle the blood over all of these items that I mentioned to you.
And the crowd would be waiting outside in anticipation. Did Jehovah God forgive us? Was the sacrifice acceptable? Because if it wasn't, the high priest would be struck dead. And that's the reason the robe that the high priest wore, at the bottom of it, pomegranates and bells. So as the high priest, as he sprinkled, they listened, and if they heard the bells ringing, the high priest was still alive. They knew that God had accepted. But if there was a prolonged absence, he would be struck dead, and no one could go into the Holy of Holies to get him. So that's why the high priest always had this long rope, so that someone could pull the body of the high priest out from the Holy of Holies. But when at last the high priest came out of the most holy place, the whole congregation breathed a sigh of relief that God had forgiven their sins, that atonement was made. Well, let me talk to you. Blood is a very strange, mysterious substance. I remember a friend of mine grew up on a farm. Live animals, chickens, pigs, hogs. He was part of the family. People would come. He would take the chicken without any qualms. Cut, blood would flow. Do the same thing with the hog. Drain without batting an eye. When that man grew older, the very sight of blood, he would pass out immediately. That's the effect it had upon him. Remember, in Spain, the bullfights? Very, very popular, weren't they? What made the conquistadores so famous? It was when he was able to spear that bull, and blood would gush forth. Animal rights people have put an end to that particular kind of situation at this time. It seems that the baser side of man likes to see blood. It excites him. Blood is a mysterious substance. The Bible does not give us the composition, the chemical composition of the red and white corpuscles, but it tells us something very mysterious about blood. And what is that? That the life of the flesh, each and every one of us, is in the blood. Who's not familiar with the blood transfusion? Probably you've had one, two, or three. You know how many quarts of blood you have in your body right now flowing through you? 5 to 7 quarts of blood. Red substance made up of plasma and corpuscles and platelets. You know as well as I, every part of your body must receive blood. If not, you begin to rot. if blood did not flow through this finger, it would begin to turn purple, and then it would eventually fall off. You're well acquainted, too, with individuals that have had blood diseases, leukemia. And thank God there's been a cure for that horrible disease. In the scripture today, we find something that we need to comprehend. I don't know, none of us know, how many categories of human blood have been cataloged by medical science. But I do know, church, that the blood type of Jesus Christ was different from any other blood type, because only his blood could atone and forgive each and every one of us. And if you're grateful, say amen.
Amen.
The blood that flowed in the veins was perfect. It was not contaminated by sin. It was only when Adam sinned that there was introduced to the human race sin and sickness. And if Adam had not sinned, he would not have died. He would not have died. It is impossible. I lack the vocabulary to describe the awesomeness of the blood of Jesus. The Apostle Peter said, it is priceless. It is priceless. It is priceless. The text reads, and take this home with you. The text reads, for the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you to make an atonement for your souls. It is in the blood, and I have given it to you. If you can only imagine with me on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the brooks were fed with the blood of animals that flowed continually for days, reminding the inhabitants that something miraculous was going to happen, that Jesus was going to be the one supreme sacrifice, and that one day each and every one of us do not have to bring a blood sacrifice. When we are under the blood, there is so much that we sometimes forget. There is no gift that God has given us, given you, given the church, that is more important than the blood of Jesus Christ. Hear me. No gift that has been given is more important than the blood of Jesus Christ. And yet many Christians do not comprehend it. Let me tell you something, and I speak from experience. Many Christians do not comprehend it, and many churches and many denominations have stopped preaching and singing about the blood of Jesus. What a tragedy.
I remember being called as a candidate to a church
in our denomination
by the pulpit committee. Sat down. They wanted to talk to me. I wanted to talk to them.
Seven of them. Large church.
Will you be our candidate? What's your doctrine? And the chair of the pulpit committee said to me, "Now, you know we're a bit progressive here, and we don't want any of that bloody stuff. The denomination of which I carry credentials, and of which this church is aligned with. God have mercy." Can you say amen, church? And I said, "Sorry, sir. The blood has never lost its power. And until the day I die, I will preach the whole counsel of the Word of God."
Amen.
Do you understand the significance of the blood? Why? And hear this. The Bible tells us when you apply the blood, it provides for you forgiveness of sins. It gives you life eternal. It brings cleansing. It gives you boldness to approach God. It sanctifies you. It heals you. It enables you to overcome the devil and his works. The Bible says they overcame him. Who is him? The evil one, the devil, by the word of their testimony and by the power of the blood. Blood is so important to God that it is mentioned in the Bible over 700 times. Don't forget that. It is mentioned in the Bible over 700 times in one capacity or another. The text, again, Moses was given this proclamation to give to the nation of Israel. The life of the flesh is in the blood. Your natural blood supplies life-giving oxygen and nutrients to every cell in your body comes from the blood. And if the flow of blood, as I mentioned before, were to be cut off, you would begin to die. And I want to make the analogy spiritually. If any part of your spiritual life is cut off from the blood of Jesus, you begin to die spiritually. And there are some people that are dying spiritually because they have not found the significance. They have not grasped. Your blood carries away wastes and toxins from your cells. Spiritually, without the blood of Jesus, your life is spiritually dead. And God has equipped our bodies with white blood cells that fight off sickness. And when your natural blood is healthy, you are protected from disease. And when your spiritual life is healthy, there isn't anything in your life that the blood of Jesus isn't sufficient to overcome. Remember when Jesus gathered his disciples? We will have that in just a few moments. At the Last Supper, and he held up the cup. He said, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Now go back with me. That day, finally, of deliverance of the children of Israel that had been slaves to the Egyptians and to the Pharaoh. The Israelites were commanded, kill a lamb, dip a branch into the blood, and take that branch that has been dipped into blood and apply it to the lintel of your doors and to the side doorposts, either side. The doorway must be covered totally with blood. Why? Because the death angel is going to pass through this evening. And when the death angel came through, the doorpost that had no blood, what was the ultimate consequence? The firstborn of that family lost his life. But those that had the blood on the doorposts, they were spared. Hallelujah. And if an Israelite, just after making the sacrifice, left the blood in the basin instead of applying it, they would have suffered the same calamity as the Egyptian family. See, the shedding of the blood, and here's the point, the shedding of the blood was not enough. The blood could only save them when it was taken out of the basin and applied. And John writes, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And what makes it possible? And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from sin. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from sin. Let me tell you something, church. When you apply the blood, you can apply the blood in any area. If you apply the blood of Jesus to your life, you can obtain healing. If the blood is applied to your life, you will be protected. Not only you, but your household. And if things are not going right in your household, have you applied the blood? Listen to me. If things are all miscombobulated, that's in the Fortunato Dictionary. Why? Why? Your household will be protected. You can apply the blood to anything that you have responsibility for and you have authority over. And Satan cannot touch you if you are under the blood. Say amen. Amen. If you are under the blood. Because the blood will never, never lose its power. Now let me conclude. When our Jewish friends gather in 10 days to celebrate Yom Kippur, hopefully, as the rabbi gives to them the scripture and prays that they will find somehow forgiveness. But that will not happen because there will be no blood sacrifice that day that is spent in synagogue. And the only way that any one of us can find forgiveness is through the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. The life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you. To you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls. I don't know about you, but I am eternally grateful for the sacrifice of my Lord. He shed his blood, as we will see in a moment, so that anything and everything I can be free, I can be delivered, I can be protected, I can face tomorrow and the tomorrows, I can face sickness, I can face any problem, because I am under the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sin? Singing 269, nothing. But the blood of Jesus. Stand as you sing verses 1 and 4.
Thank you. open communion. What do you mean, Pastor? You don't have to be a member of this church. What you do need to be a member of is the body and the church of Jesus Christ. Amen. This is not a Lutheran table or a Catholic table or a Baptist table. This is the Lord's table. Aren't you happy for that? And the only requirement is that a person examine themselves. What was the problem in the New Testament church? Why were they dying prematurely? Why was there sickness? Because they were eating unworthily. Do you know what that means? They weren't under the blood. They were eating because, again, they did not examine themselves, and that was a chastisement. And hence, Paul gave the teaching, let a person examine themselves. No one in this congregation will judge you. There is only one judge, and that is God Himself. Amen.
Amen.
You will be judged according to the Scripture. And so therefore, let a person examine themselves, that they be in the faith, and then come to the table and receive that which has been provided for you. And on the night that our Lord was betrayed, He took the bread and He broke it. And He said, take, eat, this is my body, which was broken for you. All of us have been broken. If I tried, I could not put this back together again. But Jesus can put us back together. Amen.
Amen.
See, we're all broken. Every day, we're broken. We go through situations. We are broken people. But thank God, He came to heal the broken heart and to give us and make us totally and completely whole. Brother Bob, will you ask God's blessing on this element, please?
That'll be for me today. That'll be for me today.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Bob, thanks. Lord, we thank you for the day you gave yourself, your body is broken for us.
Yes.
Thank you for all the gifts that you provided us through that day and through that sacrifice that you made. We know something. We feel our pain and shame. All of us are, as the pastor says, broken. But
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Same night, our Lord took the cup of the new covenant. This represents the blood of Jesus Christ. Again, let me remind you, we as a church believe except that one drop of this precious blood can make us whole. We do not believe in transubstantiation. What does that mean? There's some denominations of which maybe you have heard of, maybe some of your friends, family. They believe that when they take communion, that it becomes the actual body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is not true, church. Jesus died only once. Amen? Amen. We don't crucify him every month. Only once he died. Thank God. And therefore, this cup, if you are under the blood, gives you anything and everything you need. It is carte blanche. Just make sure that you are under the blood. The life of the flesh is in the blood. Brother Bob, would you ask God to bless this element?
Father God, even as we ponder this, we are amazed at the profound depth of your love.
Yes.
We acknowledge that your ways are not our own ways, and so we might reason from here unto eternity. We try to understand how this takes place, this wonderful redemption and atonement. We don't know, but what we do know is that it does.
Amen.
Take place. It does work, and it does affect the lives of people. And so we want to be just careful today to give you thanks and praise for this wonderful, matchless blood.
Yes.
That takes away my sin. Yes. Our sin.
Yes.
The sins of the world.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
And we are especially grateful for this cup. May yes. we be reminded of this as we share together. In his name, amen.
Amen. Let us drink together with thanksgiving. Okay. wash away my sin, nothing but the, say it, church.
Blood.
Say it again.
Blood of Christ.
Say it again.
Blood of Jesus.
Let us drink together with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen. Well, we had church today, didn't we?
Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together and let's sing. Blessed be the time we come. Sing together. Bless you, you are dismissed.